Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and I'm so happy because we got a great Friday show for you. A great Friday show. And second hour, the Catholic Man Show guys are going to be here. And that would be Adam Minihan and David Niles. Or Adam Niles and David Minihan. No, I did it right the first time? Okay, yeah. two wonderful, wonderful men who, with their wives, have written a brand new book that's perfect for a Friday conversation. It's about the domestic church. It's about bringing the life of the church alive in the home. And they're just also two great guys to talk to. And so that'll be the second hour. First hour, I don't think I'm going to let any callers call because Rose is here. Rose Sweet is here. And it's almost Christmas. I'm giving myself a Christmas present. I'm just going to talk to Rose for the hour.
Oh, that's so nice.
Hi, Rose Sweet.
Hi, Cy.
How are you?
I'm good.
You look quite Christmassy.
Well, you told me to dress Christmassy, and here I am.
I don't think I did. I think you're saying
well, okay, you didn't tell me, but I did see that weird jacket that everybody's been
oh,
wearing.
Oh, where'd my jacket go? No, you asked me to wear the jacket.
It's right over there.
Oh, at the break, I'll get it.
Okay.
I'll put it on.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. I forgot that you said to wear that. And you told me to wear it after it became clear that when I wear that jacket, everyone around me looks great because I look so bad in that jacket. So it definitely helps.
Cy, you could never look bad in anything.
I don't think that's. Rose Sweet is a longtime Catholic speaker and author and relationship helper. And many times you have heard her on the air here talk about issues related to marriage, because that's what she dedicates a great deal of her time to. And in addition to life coaching, and you're a busy bee when it comes to all this stuff.
Yeah, and I've been so blessed because, you know, we're all so hungry for happiness and fulfillment and relationships. And a lot of times we really need help integrating our faith into those realities. And I didn't always do a good job, for sure.
Nope, right, nor I. But it is such an important thing. And the thing is, if you really want a full life with joy in it, then the Catholic teaching on marriage and sex and relationships and all that is actually really good for you. Like, it turns out you're really happy you did if you go that route.
You do. You are.
You don't regret it.
No. In fact, you're free of a lot of big burdens. There's a lot of joy to it.
But I'll tell you what. We've all had in our families, friends, all that stuff, sometimes ourselves, the experience in the modern world of divorce. It's all over the place. And so now we're coming up to the holidays. So I thought this was a good time, not for a downer, but for an interesting conversation that might be practically helpful. You know, maybe someone that you're going to be at the Christmas party this year is divorced, and that's going to be different than the other years. Or, you want to know how to respond to a family member or to deal with that situation yourself when other people bring it up at the Christmas get-together. So divorce and the holidays is our theme today.
Well, I'm so glad you're, inviting me to do this, because the holidays just in themselves bring a whole lot of stress and pressure to everybody.
Yeah.
And so if you're facing divorce or have gone through it, or your family members are, or your kids are, there are some extra rules, I think, that we can be aware of to help.
All right. And you're welcome to call with your questions. I probably won't let you on the air because I just like talking with Rose. I tend to get criticized for not letting very many callers on when you're here.
Well, you've said that before, but
yeah, I get critiqued
really?
On that. Yeah. The number here is 888-318-7884. Look at this. I haven't even opened up the phone file here on my computer, though. Like, it's like I don't even care that people are going to call.
Wow.
888-318-7884. Now I have it open. Now I can answer the phone.
Wow. This is a whole new side. I don't think I've ever seen this side of you before.
I know. It's just like I'm doing whatever I want today.
Wow.
Huh? It's like,
uh-oh.
It's like no, I don't want to do bad things. I'm not going to... anything evil.
I would be appalled if that ever happened.
If I were to do evil on the show?
Yes.
Yeah. well, I learned, from the great philosophers, and of course, Uncle Ben is one of the great philosophers, and he said, with great power comes great responsibility. So.
This is true.
Yeah. Do you even know who Uncle Ben is?
The guy on the rice thing?
Nope.
Ben Franklin.
No, not Ben. But keep going. I want to hear who you think Uncle Ben is.
Benjamin Netanyahu.
No.
Uncle Ben. Benny and the Jets.
Does everyone in the booth know who I'm talking about when I say Uncle Ben said, with great power comes great
Benedict,
responsibility?
Oh, Benedict. Benny.
No, none of these above. But Benny and the Jets.
No. The Pope.
No, not the Pope. No. Uncle Ben. They all know in there. Everybody, every single person knows in there. Spider-Man's uncle.
Oh, for crying out the window. You young whippersnappers.
Oh, yeah. That's right. I'm a young whippersnapper. You know, Spider-Man's been around for like, I don't know.
Well, I'm going with Ben Franklin.
No, it's not. Don't, you can't, it's not I'm going with. There's a right answer and there's a wrong answer here.
Okay. I forget where I am.
All right.
You're right.
Divorce and the holidays. Help. Why don't you get this conversation started?
Oh, okay. So I brought four little tips today for your listeners. But before we get into that, I just want to paint the scene. The first thing is, if somebody that you know and love is going through divorce at the holidays, please don't pick at their wound. And what I mean by that is, don't say, oh, you need to get out of the house, come over to the party, it'll be fun, all your friends will be there. Because they may be so devastated and in need of safety and soothing, they have to stay in their little cave for a while. And they can't come to the Christmas party. Part of them maybe wants to, but they cannot. It would be way too painful.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If you're inviting somebody that you know and love who's been going through divorce right now, and you say, please come to our house, or you're very welcome, and if they say no, accept it. Just don't keep pushing it. And say, what else? Is there anything I can do for you? No, thank you. That's fine.
All right. That's actually a good piece of advice, because I think a lot of us would think, I'm really being helpful if I just insist and make them get out of that funk, out of that house, and come on over.
Right. And part of that is authentic helpfulness, but part of it is also, we don't feel comfortable when people aren't happy. We don't feel comfortable when people are in a bad mood or not happy. It kind of brings our little perfect Christmas down.
Okay.
So it's a struggle. Although there are some people who've been wallowing in their pain for a long, long, long time, and maybe they should take a shower and get out of the house and go to a party. It would be good for them. So every case is different. That's what I would say.
All right. What else?
Let me ask you a question. Do you know anybody who has gone through divorce recently, family or friends, or do you have a recollection of,
Not this year.
Okay.
I don't think there's anybody that's coming to mind this year. I mean, I've gone through it in my family, certainly.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Brothers and sisters going through divorces, that kind of thing, aunts and uncles. I mean, I think everybody goes through it these days. But I haven't even gone through a marriage with any of my children. So we haven't even done that. We haven't crossed that bridge yet.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So let's go back. Number one of the four tips that I brought is receive them, but reject their sin.
Now, okay.
What do I mean by that?
What do you mean by that?
Okay. Let's say, I always pick on you. Let's say you were my brother and you dumped Missy for no valid reason. And you filed for divorce and you started dating again and you had a hot new girlfriend.
Okay.
And you're coming to our big family holiday thing with your girlfriend.
Yeah.
I don't want her there.
I gotcha.
It's an assault to marriage. It's an affront to the family.
Yeah.
I don't want to look at your sinfulness.
Yeah. I see. So you can, I'm welcome at the party, but you don't want the hot new girlfriend there.
But then there are people who go, well, good. Christians should welcome everybody. But that's when you wrote a book, The Teacher of Strange Things. If we dive deeper into the four Gospels and really look at what Jesus said and did, he wasn't Mr. Nice Guy all the time and said, all are welcome in this place. He said, whoa, 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 come and talk with me. You got some work to do here. I love you. You're welcome. But,
Yeah. So, if I did that to Missy, I don't think, I wouldn't even want you to invite me. You should invite her. I don't think I should even get
invited. Well, I would totally side with Missy if that were the case.
I think it's fair to take sides in something like that.
Okay.
I mean,
Okay, let's get back here.
Okay.
Okay. So how do you do that, though? How do you go to your brother or your son and say, you are welcome, but your girlfriend isn't? Because you might trigger him.
Yeah.
And he'll get all mad at you, and then he won't come. And then that will ruin your Christmas if one of your children or your brothers or sisters isn't there. So then the temptation is what?
The temptation is to kind of weasel your, all right.
Okay, and then she shows up, and now you got the whole layer of other kids who are going, where's Aunt Missy?
Oh, right, yeah.
Who's that lady, Mama? Oh, well, honey, we can't talk about that right now. Yeah. But, you know, Uncle Si is like kissing her, but that's not right. I mean, this is what happens in good Catholic families.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah.
We don't know how to deal with it. And here's I've said this before here. This is not my opinion. We can always go to the gospel and look at what Jesus said and did with people. He understood us. Hebrews 4 says he was like us in everything except sin. He knows. He gets worried. He got triggered. He got a lot of things. But he teaches us how to deal with people appropriately. So
okay.
If your gut is saying this isn't right, this is violating something, please listen to that.
Yeah.
And get creative. Talk to a priest or a wise and holy Catholic friend and say, what is a good solution here? You can get creative and say, you know what, son? I don't want you to bring her, and I don't have to explain it, but you are welcome. And if this relationship lasts and I don't know where it goes, I'm not, you know, close to meeting her at some point down the road, but certainly after you either try to reconcile your marriage or get an annulment, but not right now.
Yeah. Okay. That seems very, very fair. Yeah. But I do think that might, we might not immediately think that, you know?
Divorce is, all of our heads go down to the pavement and we're in shock and we're like, you know, blah, 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 and what do we say? What do we do? And that's why I've lived this. I've said the wrong things. I've been too pastoral and bent over backwards and at the end tolerated something. I go with that. You know what?
I
shouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
Should have been stronger.
All right. You got more of these about dealing with divorce. Dealing with divorce at the holidays. But I got to take a break, Rose.
Okay.
So we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more with Rose Sweet on this Friday afternoon here in Southern California. Maybe Friday evening where you are. Maybe even Saturday morning where you are. We're talking about dealing with divorce at the holidays. More of that right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catch Catholic Answers Live anytime at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
How are you listening to EWTN Radio right now? Have you ever wished you could listen on a local radio station? Maybe our Lord is speaking to your heart to help make that happen. Don't let a lack of experience hold you back. Find out how you can help start a Catholic radio station where you live. Powered by the truth of the church and EWTN's dynamic radio programming. Email Steve at this address, radio@EWTN.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Rose Sweet is our guest. All the lines are open because I haven't given out the phone number, I don't think. 888-318-7884. Also, I was kind of negative on callers, but I'm only playing around. I just enjoy talking with Rose. And you can call. We'd love to talk with you. 888-318-7884. Maybe there's been a recent divorce in the family. Maybe there's one that is in the works or anticipated, and you just don't know what to do. If you'd like some help from Rose, 888-318-7884. Rose is in the midst of giving us her four tips for dealing with divorce at the holidays. Tip number two.
Wait. First of all, that jacket is amazing.
Thank you.
Amazing.
Thank you.
And I think it looks better on you than it did Father Keyes.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, because it doesn't clash with his shirt, but it clashes with mine. So it brings out the full power
No,
of
it's
the jacket.
Interesting. Okay, so.
It's interesting in a hypnotic, slightly nausea-producing
Okay,
way.
Can you look at me instead of yourself in the screen? Okay, come on.
No, I can't. I can't stop looking. Look at the beauty of that jacket. Okay, I'll stop. Sorry.
Okay, you and I are playful by nature, and we bring that out in each other, and
yes.
I love that, okay? And I know a lot of the listeners do, too. But this is a serious topic.
Yes.
And I don't want anybody to think that we're making light of the pain of divorce. Definitely. I just wanted to say that.
Okay.
We are having fun. It's getting close to Christmas. I'm excited. But this is a serious thing, and we're here to help. So thank you for that.
All right.
One more thing about receive them but reject their sin. I wanted to say, if it's your family member or your friend who's going through divorce and you're dealing with them, but you were friends with their spouse.
Oh, yeah.
You still have a relationship with the one who got left behind or dumped or whatever, or maybe that's the person who left.
Right.
Reach out to them at the holidays separately.
Oh, that's such a good tip.
Just reach out and say, I know this is a tough time of year for everybody. Don't say you or him or her. Just say for everybody. And I want to let you know you're in my prayers. We love you. If you want to pop by for a cocktail sometime in the next few weeks or whatever, please do. But don't push, but let that other person know you didn't just drop them like a hot potato just because there's a divorce going on.
Very good. Okay, got it.
Okay, number two. First one was receive them, but reject their sin. Number two is feed them, don't fix them.
What does that mean?
Oh, God. Every man, when you say, please don't fix the problem, they're like, what? That's what we do.
I don't know.
That's exactly right. Okay. So invite the person who is over, going through divorce or struggling or depressed or angry or whatever. Maybe they're consumed with it and they come over and they're at the party and they start talking all about their divorce. You don't have to fix their problem. You don't have to tell them that divorce is a sin. You don't have to tell them they need to get to confession. That is not the proper time and place at the family event to fix their problems. Even Jesus didn't stop the wedding feast at Cana. I have to deal with this guy over here. He's in a state of mortal sin.
Yeah, right. Know
that God is going to lead those people to the truth and to healing and redemption his way in his time, and you may be part of it, you may not be part of it.
That's so helpful, Rose, because there is always the anxiety of how much fraternal correction, so to speak, am I supposed to get? How much am I responsible for this? How much? But you're saying, look, at the holidays, don't do that. Don't turn this into a trying to fix people opportunity.
Because it's not your responsibility at that time and place.
Okay.
So if you're struggling and you really want to pull your brother aside or whatever and say, you're in major, this is not good, do it separately. Say, you know, can we go out to lunch? Can I come over and visit? I'll bring a pie or whatever. But if you need to do it, but at the proper time and place and the proper way. The other thing I learned too is say at one time. So again, I'm your sister, you've dumped Missy, and the party's tonight, but I come over to your house a few hours early. I go, you know what? Mom and Dad are really upset at what you've done. So am I. But I want to say this right now. You haven't been to marriage therapy with Missy. And before you decide to leave, you need to go work everything out that you can so that you, if you have to leave, it's in good conscience. I have to say that to you, Si, because I'm your sister and I love you. I'm not going to bring it up at the party tonight.
Okay.
But I'm saying it right now.
Ah, very good. Yeah.
And I'm done. If you don't listen to me and you're still hopping down the bad little path, I don't call you up again and say, didn't you hear what I said?
Yeah, that's right, right. Yeah.
Say it one time. Remember the rich young man came to Jesus and said, how do I get to heaven? And Jesus told him,
yeah, right.
He told him one time.
Yeah.
And the guy wasn't ready and he walked away. We don't read that Jesus chased him down and gave him another version of it.
Right.
So we take the responsibility because I think sometimes we don't understand how much God loves us. I have to correct my brothers and sisters at the right time and place, but God's not going to cast me into hell if I don't do it perfectly or I don't do it enough. He knows my heart.
Yeah. So let go of that anxiety.
Go of the anxiety of God judging you for not saving the soul of the divorced person.
Right. Okay.
Does that make sense?
That makes very good sense, okay. Yes.
So feed them, don't fix them. And if at the party, if a big discussion starts happening or a big argument, just step in, put your hand on everybody and say, Hold that thought. Let's take it outside. Just as you would any other discussion about something at a party.
And then you fight when you get outside?
Yeah. Really? Of course. Yeah.
Like?
Yeah, you duke it out. If you have to.
Wow.
Right? Did Jesus turn over tables?
He did, yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay. We're being playful again. Okay, number three. Love them, don't force them. And this kind of goes into the second one. If they don't listen to you, if they're not responding to you, if you can see that they're not even responding to God, just love them anyway. We're not on earth to save everybody. That's God's job. We're supposed to partner with him in the vineyard.
Mm-hmm.
And there are hours that we keep as if we're working with the Lord in the vineyard, like in the parables. You know, we show up at work, we leave at a certain time. We're not 24/7 with the whole burden on us of fixing and saving everybody. The other thing is, don't take it upon yourself to talk to their children. This is bad for...
Okay, now, I don't know exactly what you mean. So two people are divorcing in the family, say.
Right, right.
And what would be the thing that would be wrong to do with the
children? Okay, so I'm grandma, right?
Oh, okay.
Well, honey, your mother has to leave your father because he's a bad man.
Oh, yeah.
He lost the family fortune and he has a girlfriend and the Lord does not like that. Or even worse, I've heard this, the devil has entered your father. I've literally heard this from Catholic families. Daddy is filled with the devil, and so we have to stay away from him, and your mommy didn't have a choice. So now that's totally destroying the relationship.
Between the child and the
father. Yes, and shaking up their foundation and their trust and their ability to love the other parent.
Okay, I gotcha. All right, so... Yeah.
We take sides and then we move in and then we're going to tell, especially kids, if they're not your kids, shut your mouth. There's a psalm that says, Lord, set a watch about my mouth and a guard about my lips.
Okay. So you love the kids, you treat them with the same everything you
right.
always have, but it's not your job.
No, so what if your kids come up and go, Daddy's having an affair and we're getting a divorce. You just go, oh, honey, here's another chocolate cookie. You know, just bypass that. You're not obligated to respond to that. Just move into that child, put your hand on them, ask them questions, love on them, show them the presents under the tree, anything. You're not obligated to answer every question or statement that's thrown out like that.
Okay.
And most of us aren't qualified to.
Yeah. Now that's small children.
Even teenagers.
Uh-huh.
Don't pull the teenagers aside and go, oh, I'm so sorry about this divorce, but I've seen it coming. You know, your mom's a, you know what?
Yeah. And the devil's
no,
in her.
No.
Okay.
Stop.
That's actually, again, Rose, I find this very helpful because the temptation is to do just the opposite, is to maybe overhelp.
Good. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So to set the record straight, to make the truth clear, to pave way, make this path straight for the Lord and all that. We're just really what's happening is we have a genuine good desire to help, but mixed in with is our own fears and misconceptions.
Okay.
And so I would say ask the Lord for clarity.
Let's do the last one, and then I'll tell you what, we'll take a break and we'll take calls when we come back because there are folks on the line ready to talk with you. There are lines open, 888-318-7884. The last point, Rose.
Number four, lead them, don't lecture them.
The them is who?
The person going through the divorce.
Gotcha.
Or really anybody involved in this.
All right.
Where do we lead them? We lead them to the truth. And the truth is they are precious in the eyes of God and they are loved and it is Christmas and here's an eggnog.
Yeah.
So lead them, but don't lecture them. Don't take them down the hall and say, your father and I are very upset. Stop.
Stop laying burdens on them.
Let me say that again. Receive them, but you can reject their sin, mm-hmm. but deal with it differently, somewhere else. Feed them, but don't fix them.
Mm-hmm.
Love them, but don't force them. And lead them, and don't lecture them.
Okay.
These are hard.
Yeah, they are, but they sound like a little fence around the relationship, so that you're not going to destroy that relationship. this kind of crisis moment.
Well, right, but you're not intruding. And this is, here it is. Number one was from John 8:11. These are things that Jesus did. He received people, but he rejected their sin. He fed them, but he didn't always fix them if they didn't want to be fixed.
Yeah.
John 2, Mark 10, you know, Jesus used parables. This is all from Jesus.
Rose Sweet is our guest, and I'm going to let you talk with her now. 888-318-7884 is the number. If you're dealing with divorce in your family, maybe in the workplace, whatever it is, if you'd like some help with exactly what to say or how to deal with a situation, whether it is your own divorce that is the subject or someone else's, your call is welcome here. And as always, you don't have to be Catholic to call. 888-318-7884. Rose is going to give you a Catholic answer one way or the other, but anybody can call. 888-31-TRUTH.
Catholic Answers Live.
The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement, but the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whywearepro-life.com.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
This is Dr. David Anders. Join us for an engaging hour of questions and answers about the Catholic faith here on Called to Communion, Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Rose Sweet is our guest. We're talking about divorce at the holidays, dealing with divorce at the holidays. 888-318-7884 is the number. And I'm feeling some urgency now because all of a sudden at that break, all the phone lines filled up. So you willing to just chat with people now?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, let's go to Joseph right here in California, watching on YouTube. Joseph, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Rose.
Yes. Thanks for taking the call. I don't know if I have a question per se. I'm just very struck, inspired to call the germane, very germane of the. Here's my situation. Okay, so I'm 43. My parents divorced when I was around 10 or 11. My father, and the impetus for that was my father was an infidelity with his mm-hmm. high school sweetheart, who he's now married to. My mother's since passed. Mm-hmm. It's a very particularly around the holidays, can be a very difficult reminder of things. I don't live a life of bitterness by any means.
But it comes back around at the holidays.
It comes back around. Yes,
yeah. Let me get Rose to respond, and we'll come right back to Joseph.
Joseph, I'm so sorry to hear that. You were traumatized at age 11. This is divorce is trauma. It brings trauma to everybody involved, whether they admit it or aware of it or not. And so you are suffering, as many adult children still do, from the effects of that trauma because it hasn't been fully grieved or fully healed. And so you have, in a certain sense, PTSD from your parents' divorce. Does that make sense? Okay, so that means you need to be very tender with yourself, very patient and very loving. And the first thing I would say is go to our Lord. He understands your pain. He understands your unhealed grief. He wants to bring you healing and comfort and direction. So I would not be ashamed of it. I would own it and take it to the Lord in prayer. And then if you can, get a good therapist or counselor with Christian worldview to help you process through the remnant of grief that you carry. That little 11-year-old you is still carrying that grief from that horrible trauma. So, our Lord is still in the business of healing all of us.
Amen.
So
Amen.
Run to Him, and Joseph, be assured of my prayers too.
Okay, Joseph?
Well, thank you so much. God bless.
God bless
you too, Joseph. God bless you. Thank you so much for the call. Every single line filled up now. So off we go to Michigan. Aaron in Hastings, Michigan. Aaron, thanks for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Rose.
Hi, Rose. Hi, Sai. Thanks for taking my call.
Happy to.
Hi, Aaron.
I've actually been divorced now for probably about close to 10 years. Give or take a year or two. But every time around this year, because this is about the time that we separated, I don't know if it's stress, anxiety, what, but it's always hard for me this time of year. I know for me, I tend to get verbal, I guess, out of pure frustration and with my bipolar and PTSD and everything else that I have. I was actually wondering, how would I go about getting over that?
Well, Aaron, again, I'm sorry. You suffered trauma. Regardless of how it came about, divorce is traumatic, and it gets down to the deepest layers of the human person. And what are the holidays? They are the time where we get most idealistic. We long most for everything to be perfect and beautiful and good and true. We're really looking for a little foretaste of heaven in all its sparkle and its lights and its music and its food. Really, that's what we're all longing for at this time of year. And anything that can intrude on that and bring us down, it's like somebody, ripping the curtains apart and saying, you are looking at something fake. Here's the reality, and it's horrible, and down we go. So really what has to happen for all of us to get over these things or to get through them is to change the way we see them and think about them. And it's hard to do on your own. Aaron, I would totally recommend that you would go get a few sessions with somebody to just listen to you process your unresolved hurt and your pain. And it sounds like you have some issues. Are you already getting in some kind of therapy or help?
No.
Okay, go get it. Because, Aaron, if your car started pinging, making funny noises, and the car tires, you would go to a mechanic. And if your teeth started hurting, you would go to a dentist. You're carrying a lot of pain, naturally, inside, and you need to go to a doctor for that. And there's no shame in it. There's nothing but good healing waiting for you, and our Lord will meet you in that place. He is waiting to bring you hope and healing.
Aaron, God bless you, and thank you very much for the call. I didn't realize how quickly the phones would fill up once we open the line. So there's a lot of folks on the line, Rose. So Aaron, you'll excuse me if I keep going to try to get everybody on that I can with Rose. I'm going to go to Texas now. Addie is in Texas, listening on 1180 AM. Addie, go ahead with your question for Rose.
Hi. So I'm 25. I don't have kids. I was married 2 years ago for 6 months, and the marriage got annulled about 6 months after the marriage ended. About 3 months after, I got into a wonderful relationship with a great Catholic guy. He also had no kids, and he had never been married before. We ended up getting engaged, and he broke off the engagement 2 weeks ago. I'm really struggling. Yeah, I'm really struggling because all I wanted to be is a wife and a mom. I've done college. I work in the life movement. And I just want to be a mom and be married.
I know, honey.
It's hard.
I know, honey.
Because I'm being judged for a mistake that I made. And it's in my past, and I just don't know how to get past it. Because I have no problem getting dates and attracting men. But when they, you know about my baggage, it's,
okay.
It's almost like I'm damaged goods.
Okay.
Wow.
I know, Addie. Thank God bless you, honey. I was like you way, way back in the day, too. All I wanted was a husband, home, and kids. I just felt it into every one of the cells in my body. It was, but I wasn't yet ready, and I was too anxious because I was actually afraid if I didn't find that spot, who would I be, where would I go, where would I end up? So I realized it was my fears that were triggering an imbalanced anxiety. And that's what I hear in your voice, too. I think your desires to be a wife and a mom are beautiful and good. I would say that, again, as I've been saying to the other callers, get somebody professional to walk alongside you and process what's happened, how you got into a marriage, how it got annulled, what you brought or to the table. Maybe you didn't see things. You had blinders on. And work through that so you can learn how to properly move forward. But I, around this holiday right now, and I know this is hard, just take a deep breath, go do something fun, be with people who love you, and say, I'm going to tackle this in 2023. Do not work yourself up into a big thing for the next few weeks, okay?
And okay. Sorry for crying.
No. Do not apologize, honey. You're letting your heart out, and this is good. And you email me, rose@rosesweet.com, and maybe I can give you some help next year.
Okay, thank you,
sweetie.
So much.
Mm-hmm.
God bless you, Addie. Thank you so much for that call. Well, I'm going to take a break. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back. That's a tough one. It's funny because
this is a hard time of year, Si.
Yeah. You and I react differently to Addie. Like, I think it's because I have adult daughters. I want to...
Want to shake her shoulders?
Not her. I want those young men who treat her like that.
I know, but you know what, though? She'll continue to attract that until she does her own work.
Okay. All right.
Okay, so we got to work on her, not the boys.
So I got to stop beating up my daughter's boyfriends?
Yep.
Okay, fair enough. All right. We'll be right back with more Rose Sweet. We're talking about divorce at the holidays. Lots of folks on the line. We'll get to that right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City. And you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
This is Conversations with Consequences, where we delve deeper into issues affecting our church, our country, and our core, the family.
As Catholics, we need to be informed, aware, and able to talk through some of the tough topics that we're facing in our culture and in our world. Conversations with Consequences gives us the tools to do so.
It's not enough to pray. We have to be a light for the world.
Conversations with Consequences, tomorrow at 5 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Melissa. It doesn't seem to be.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Rose Sweet is our guest this hour, and Rose proposed, she always proposes several topics when we were going to have her on, and I don't know, I wanted to do the divorce one, because I know it's very, very hard at this time of year, and I didn't realize quite how strong the reaction would be. Lots of folks on the line want to talk about dealing with divorce at the holidays, whether it's as a divorce that happened maybe in your family when you were a child, and still dealing with it, all the way up to relationships breaking up just this year or even within weeks of right now. So you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. We'll do our best to get you on. Am I going to line four? You want me to go to line four? Is that all right?
You pick the number.
All right. I didn't know. I couldn't. I knew you were saying something to me. I didn't know if it was don't go to line
four. No, I said I really like that jacket. That's what I was saying.
Okay, that's what everyone's saying. Melissa in Richmond, Virginia, listening on the Iowa Catholic Radio app. We're glad you're here. Melissa, go ahead with your question for Rose.
Thanks. I guess my question is, I wanted to get some clarification about the idea of inviting them in but rejecting the sin. It seems to me that, if someone in my family were going through a divorce, and even though I don't approve of that, if they wanted to bring their friend with them to supper, it seems like it would be uncharitable for me to say you can't bring that person, because that would be me assuming that they're committing adultery with that person, and that would be me passing judgment and ignoring the 2x4 in my eye. Do you feel like having them over is scandal?
Okay, I'm glad you used that word. At face value, it looks like you're being uncharitable and you're being harsh and you're not being humble, but it really isn't about you as much as everybody else involved. And it does bring scandal. And the example I used was a freshly divorced person where nobody, and all of a sudden you see this new person that they're showing public displays of affection, and it causes confusion, hurt, anger, fear, anxiety. It's bad for everybody. And you use the word friend, if they want to bring their friend over, look, if Cy was my brother and got divorced and he brought his friend Jim over, no problem. But if it was Susie and she was real cute and she was hanging on to him the whole time, no, because that is causing scandal. And it's saying that, you know what, you can do whatever you want and ignore the church teachings, and we won't bat an eye and we won't say anything, because we value peace more than we value the truth. It's a hard place to be in, and every situation is different, Melissa, right? So you can't give a blanket answer to every single situation. Who is the divorced person? How long? Who are they bringing? What's going on? Who's going to be there? Here's another thing. What if I was just inviting, my husband and I were inviting one of our sons over who dumped his wife or whatever and came up with his new girlfriend? There's nobody else to give scandal to, I still would not like it, but if he showed up with her, I wouldn't kick her to the curb and go, you can't come in. But I would keep it short, and I would have a nice come to Jesus talk with my son after dinner, the next day or two. Here, we have to find that balance between loving people and not tolerating obvious, obvious flouting of sin in the family or in the culture. And it takes practice, and this is why we're talking about it on air. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad you brought this up, Melissa, so we can clarify this. Does that help at all?
It does. Thank you. And I would have problems with the public displays of affection, too, because I think that's tacky and scandalizing. But I definitely see where you're coming from. Thank you for clarifying.
Yes, thank you, Melissa.
Thanks, Melissa. I think it's cool that Melissa's in Virginia listening on the Iowa Catholic Radio app.
They have radio in Iowa?
They have a great Iowa Catholic
radio.
I know.
I've been to Iowa.
It's just wild that these, you can, people, we'll get calls from overseas, people listening on an American Catholic radio app or something.
And they ask in a different language, where can I get that jacket?
No, nobody ever asks where they can get this jacket. they go, could you please turn that jacket off? We can see it over here. Teresa in Washington, D.C., listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Glad you're here, Teresa. Go ahead with your question for Rose.
Yes, thank you. I just want to say to you, I'm not married, never been married, not divorced, but let me say to you, my dear lady, the things that you're sharing, I find that can be used and helping in other areas that where you find yourself into places that could need dance. I love what you're sharing. And I was listening. I said, oh, my goodness, I can use this even in areas where maybe some family members may step out in other areas to do a faith thing. And you just say, no, hold this. You're going to say it once, and you're not going to say it. I love it. Thank you for your information.
Well, Teresa, thank you for being a fan, but you know what? Let's give praise to our Lord, because when I can't figure out my relationships, I know when I go to the gospel and I read what Jesus said and did to other people, I said, there it is. There's our answer, right? He knew how to do this.
I thank you so very, and I do. I've never even listened to Catholic Answers before. I just happened to have it on going through the trial.
No.
I didn't even know the program was about divorce. I just heard you say somebody was sharing something, and you said, no, you just say it once, and then you just said, you're not going to say it again. And there was something before that. I thought, oh, wow. And then I heard you saying it was for divorce. So I thought, oh, well, my dear, I will take your information, not in that situation. I will use it wherever I need it, because it can be used in other areas where people may not be behaving and moving in a way once they need to. You want to point them to Christ, and you don't have to do it in being ugly, but in showing and pointing them to Christ and still love them. Thank
right.
You.
Wow. Teresa, thank you. And please tune into Catholic Answers again. There are great guests here all the time, great topics. And I don't get paid to say this, but it is. It's a great show.
She didn't get
God
paid
bless
to say
you.
Anything. We're not paying you, Rose.
In fact, I have to pay you guys.
Oh, it's not a lot.
What?
It's a small amount.
$500 a month?
Come I like on. What Teresa had to say, though, because there is the thing about the $500 a month. Where's the money going? I haven't seen any of this, Darren. What? I'm just finding about this now?
You were saying about Teresa?
There's a way in which, like, what I really appreciated about what Teresa said is that spiritual wisdom and, like the things you said, you know, you go to the gospel and Christ gives us the example of how to relate to other people. It has a power beyond just the one particular instance. You can learn. So, like, even, like, one of the examples you gave about how to deal with divorce was you took it from how Jesus dealt with the rich young ruler.
Right.
Well, that had nothing to do with divorce, but it's right. But it's a wise spiritual approach. And I do think Teresa was very wise to call attention to this. If there's a wise spiritual approach, it will work in the matter of divorce, but it will work in other areas as well.
Right. We are a principle-centered faith, and that's what I love about it. I mean, we're about the truth, you know, and the fullness of truth. So that's the good news.
The number here is 888-318-7884. There's a few more folks on the line, but we're going to try our very best to get them on. If you just want to give me a name and a location, we'll get them on the air. Because I do want everybody that wants to talk to Rose to get a chance to talk with Rose. But the second hour, the Catholic Man Show guys will be here, Adam and David. And they and their wives, the four of them, four authors. I don't even know how you do a book with four authors, but they love each other and they're good, you know, people. But they put together a really beautiful book on how to bring the faith into the home, how to live the faith in the home with the kids, with the, you know, with the whole family. And it's a beautiful book. So we'll talk about that next hour. I'm going to go right now to Tom in Omaha, Nebraska. Tom, thanks for calling. Go ahead with your question for Rose.
Oh, thank you, Rose. Here's a question I want to ask you. It's really not about divorce, but I want to ask you. Did you say you were shocked that they have radio in Iowa?
Okay.
Oh, come
okay.
on, Tom.
Okay. No, hang on. I have some wonderful clients in Iowa, and I've spoken in churches in Iowa. I love everybody in Iowa.
In other words, yes,
okay,
she did say it, Tom.
No,
she did say it.
You must have misunderstood
no,
me, Tom.
No, you didn't misunderstand her.
No,
she
no,
said
I
it.
I said Florida.
Why do you say that, Tom? Why do you ask?
Because she said, when we said something about Iowa, then she said, do they have radio in Iowa?
Yeah, I heard her.
I was being a smartass.
She was being
kind of snide. That
yes.
wasn't very nice.
No, it was
okay.
extremely...
Tom, please forgive me.
Extremely snide and unnice, and not nice. And it really runs counter to I never say any smart alecky things. And you probably noticed that about me, Rose.
Okay, Tom. I take full responsibility, but I do have to say that Cy does egg me on, so you kind of have to blame him, too.
I apologize for that, Rose. But we have gotten each other into trouble quite a few times. Mac in Moore Park, California, you are up next. Go ahead with your question for Rose. Well, hang on, Mac. I pushed the wrong button. Okay, go ahead, Mac.
Thank you. So one of the biggest obstacles I have in the church is... people having all sorts of different experiences regarding church teaching. And a friend of mine recently said that she left the church because she couldn't receive communion because she wasn't married in the church. So my final question is, if you're not married in the church formally, can you receive communion?
Okay, this is a wonderful question. What is Holy Communion? It is a private act and a public act of professing that you stand with and hold true and believe all that the church holds forth as true, and that you are in communion with the Catholic Church and her teachings. If you are not, then, and you are not baptized Catholic and you don't hold those to be true, then you are not in communion in that level. And if you certainly were baptized Catholic and married outside the church, because for whatever reason you didn't want to get married in the church, then you've stepped outside of full communion with the church. You're still in some sort of communion by reason of your baptism, but you are no longer in full communion. And, you know, one of the examples I'll never forget is when one of our boys in high school mouthed off to his father in a most inappropriate way. It was horrible. And he ran out of the house. And when he came back later that day, he was not permitted to come in and sit down and watch TV and eat at the family dinner table. He was not welcome. He was still part of the family and had our love. But he had some reparation to do and some correction to do with what his choices were. So he had to, you know, make apologies and have our little talk and be restored into full communion. Does that make sense?
Yes, I believe so.
All right, Mac. Sorry, Mac. I thought you were done. Go ahead.
I have a friend who did that, but then who kind of grew up in the church, but then you know, let's say my parents who did not grow up in the church got married were married, you know, previously, and did all the sacraments after that and you know, converted into the church and you know, we, you know, converted the family and everything, but then just haven't done that final step of getting married in the church, but have been, you know, receiving communion and, you know.
But they were married everything. Before they came into the Catholic Church?
Yes.
Okay. So if they're still married and there's no impediment, this is called being healed at the root. They can go to their Catholic priest and tell him their situation and say, we married outside the church, but we are married. Our vows still stand. We intend to stay married. And they can have their marriage convalidated, that is, brought into the full communion with the Catholic Church and raised to the level of a sacrament if they're both baptized.
But if they were married already and baptized came into the Catholic Church,
okay,
then they're married.
They have to get an annulment, or that prior spouse has to have passed away.
But they were married to each other, is what I'm understanding.
Oh, okay.
So they're fine.
No. They still have to formally be acknowledged.
Oh, they were married to somebody else before?
They married outside the church, right?
Before they were Catholic.
Oh, so yeah, so when they went through RCIA and were received into the church, their marriage was probably already convalidated.
That's what I was thinking. That's
if the pastor and the RCIA team did their job.
Rose, Merry Christmas. I love it when you come here. I really
know,
do.
Me too. And that was a tough topic, but thank you.
Yeah, I'm glad we did it, though. And I'm glad that people from Nebraska called to stand up for the state of Iowa. I don't think they needed to, but I'm glad they did. Adam and David, right after this on Catholic Answers Live. Bye. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. I told you it was going to be a good Friday show, and it is a good Friday show. And that goodness continues with our next two guests, the two men from the Catholic Man Show, Adam and David, and with their wives, Haley and Pamela. They have written a brand new book called Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. It's from Ascension Press. Two things about it. It's a beautiful book. I mean, not just like physically beautiful, but it is a beautiful book about just what it says, making your home a holy place. And the best part of the book, I would say, is the blurbs. Adam and David, welcome. So glad you guys are here.
There was that one blurb too that I really liked.
Yeah,
that one guy.
Yeah. Host of Catholic Answers Live. Yeah. Hey, thanks for having us, Cy.
I'm so happy to have you. And because you know, I don't get asked to blurb a book a lot, so you pretty much know you're going to get invited on the show if you ask me to blurb your book.
It was strategic.
Well, you just hope you're ready, Cy, because you just said that on the air.
Yeah. And, you
know, a lot of people out there.
All right. Well, let's start with this. Maybe just tell me about what occasioned the book. What brought it around the four of you saying, let's write this book? But before I even let you answer this, I am going to describe something, because I have been to both of your houses. From the front porch of David's house, you can see Adam's house. And from the front porch of Adam's house, you can see David's house. And their children all know each other. And they're beautiful family friends. It's a beautiful thing. Now, one of you probably moved since then, and you're going to say, no, we can't do that anymore. But I just want you to know, these are two families that are living the Christian faith in their home. You see it in the home. You experience it in the kids. It really is a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful friendship. Lots of beautiful friendships among the two families. So, what got the four of you together to write the book? You said, we live this close together. We should probably do something in our spare time.
Yeah, you know, like we should do something.
Yeah, we're not doing anything
that's notable.
Yeah.
For once in our lives.
Yeah. Oh, is that what it was? Okay. All right. Very good.
Yeah. No, we actually wrote a few articles for the Diocesan Magazine here, the Diocese of Tulsa in Eastern Oklahoma. And at the end of it, I said, you know, we should like put this together as an ebook or something like that. And I think I said it on air. And when I did, somebody from Ascension Press reached out and said, hey, why don't we turn this into a real book? And a couple years later,
here it is.
And in the beginning, we said, oh, yeah, great. Let's make a book, because it's already done.
We've already written it.
We'll just take all these articles that we wrote on the domestic church and just put them together.
It doesn't work that way, does it?
You're like, you got a book. And then we found out, like, oh.
We had no idea.
It's got a lot to do still.
Yeah, because Ascension Press makes very, very good books. And so I'm sure they wanted the very best from you. And are you happy with what you got? Are you happy with the end product?
Yeah, you know what I was going to say? If you are someone who's considering publishing a book, I highly recommend Ascension. They have been nothing but great to work with. I've heard a lot of not-so-great stories from other people who use other publishers, and there's a lot of good publishers out there, but we have really liked Ascension.
All right.
Yeah, we've had some good feedback. Even Bishop Condola, the Bishop of the Diocese of Tulsa, he actually wrote the foreword for us, and we've had several dioceses pick up the book for marriage prep.
Oh, wonderful. So, that's great. That's a perfect use for it. And I thought that the foreword was beautiful. I did not think it was as good as the blurbs. I thought I still will stick with my idea that was the best part of the book. But you know that we have a publishing house, though, right?
Like, I was also going to say, not to exclude, of course, Catholic Answers Publishing.
Okay. That's right.
Who? I just wanted to make sure, in case Todd's listening.
Yeah.
But, no.
Hey, Todd.
Yeah,
still. I hope
big fan.
Todd, still be friends.
Yeah,
still be friends, Todd.
Yeah, I think the two of you might even owe Todd a manuscript. Is that possible?
Yeah, I think someone does.
That is true. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
In fact, Cy, last time we were on Catholic Answers, I was going to start giving away other people's book from Catholic Answers. Just typically you get to hang on the line and we'll get you a free book.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, perfect. When I come on, I'm going to give away Trent's book. I'm going to give away Tim's book. Jimmy's going to have 20 books gone out of his, and I was going to give them all away, and I forgot.
We'd like to send you 25 copies of Jimmy's latest book. Thanks for asking that question.
Well,
but we forgot to do that. So.
The apologists don't mind if you do that, because that comes out of the radio budget. So they probably still get paid for those books. I don't know. But Darren faints every time that happens. But
All right. So the Catholic Man Show, St. Michael Catholic Radio, yes. lots of kids, beautiful marriages. Can you still see each other from each other's front porch, or has one of you moved? Did one of you move?
He moved.
I moved.
Yeah, Dave moved. Dave moved just recently. Yeah. His family's growing. Both of our families are growing. Yeah. So
we're
having number five. Thank you. We have baby number five, and we were in a 3-bedroom house, and it was just time for a little more space. So, yeah.
So the two of you really have embraced the four of you really have embraced the Catholic, not just view, but the Catholic kind of culture of marriage, the Catholic, the whole idea of married Catholic life. Why would you recommend that to other people? Why would you say to people, hey, look, here's a great way to live your life. Be married, welcome children, live the Catholic faith in your home. Why would you do that?
Well, I mean, I think there's practical reasons. One, look at the families who are doing that, and you tell me if you think they're happy.
Yeah.
Okay, look at the man in that marriage, look at the women, look at the children, and you decide for yourself whether or not you think that's a life worth having. Compare that to the alternative. A lot of couples who don't seem to have those same priorities. And then you look at them, you decide if you think that those couples are happy, and you can be the judge for yourself about which one you think is a better one to pursue.
I'm so glad you said that, because so often the complaint about Catholics is we're all otherworldly and it's all in the next life, and you know, we're not realistic about this life. But it is actually a realistic call. To live a fully Catholic marriage is actually quite realistic for this world.
Yeah, in fact, Bishop Condorla, he's one of 12, and he tells a story that when his parents were having their family anniversary or their wedding anniversary, they had the whole family together. And they showed a picture of them when they were first married. And then they showed a picture of all of them all together. And they said, like, look what has happened in the 45 years that we've been married. Look at all these people that now exist because of this marriage and the fruit of this marriage. And it's just a beautiful thought that, you know, as you grow older and you look back and you see, you know, all these people that are now in existence that now love you, that you love them. It's just a beautiful idea that this happened, this fruit came from marriage.
By the way, if you want to talk with Adam and David, give us a call, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. No asking them about whiskey on this. I know they talk about whiskey all the time, but no asking them about whiskey on this, during this hour. Just take a break from that for this hour. What the church teaches actually, and what the church has, the wealth that she has, I guess is a way to say it, is actually for the home. It when it permeates the home, it does something. That, at least that's what I get out of the book. And I read, you know, one of the nice things when people are kind enough to ask you to blurb the book is they send you the book and you get to read it. It's really good. It's really good. But what it seems to be trying to do in every chapter is to say two things. One, bring this into the home and wonderful goods will come for it. And practically, in a practical sense, here's how you do that. Why does it work so well? Why does the Catholic faith in the home bring such good?
Because it's true. It's like the easiest answer. But in Genesis, God's making man and woman. He's not building like a church. He's not building a city. He's building a family. Okay, that's what God creates in the beginning, is the family. And so from the beginning, he had an idea of how it should go. And when we live our lives according to that original plan for the love between a man and a woman and their children and how all of that God intended to be, then things are just going to go better. You know, that's what you learn from everything beyond the first chapter of Genesis, is that when you don't do that, things do not go well.
Yeah. Right.
So, I know it's not really complicated, but when you follow God's will for the family, for your life, and if you're married, then I can already tell you a lot about God's will for you, because sometimes following God's will is kind of mysterious, and you think, what is he? You know, does he want me to buy the BMW or the Mercedes or the Honda? You know, it's like, you know, sometimes there are hard choices. You got to really figure things out. But if you're married, okay, great. We know your vocation. So I can already tell you that God's will for you is to be the best husband that you can be, to be the best father you can be, and that all of the other decisions should flow from those central things. That comes first, and then everything else serves those main things in your life.
Again, 888-318-7884, the number. I'm about to take a break, and then we'll get to some calls. 888-31-TRUTH. The thing you see in the world is, I see this anyways. I don't know if you see it. There seems to be an insinuation that Christians, Catholic people living as you and your spouses and children live, they're not really as happy as they let on. There's actually, it's some kind of repression or something that they're going through. And it seems to me that people make that kind of, they depict the Christian family that way in media because they actually can't imagine that family life could be happy in the way that it is happy for you guys.
Well, it's definitely possible. I mean, we're not the poster children for that, but it's definitely possible. And once you find out that if you serve others, we're called to serve one another. That's what's going to bring us fulfillment. That's what, like, we're called to do. So when you, like Dave was saying, when you get married, your vocation is now to another person, that you guys strive to work in God's plan to get to heaven. And so once you have the end in mind, then you can judge what you're doing, either good or bad, for that end. And so that's why we try to put this book together to give practical reasons, right? Si, if I asked you, or I asked any of these listeners, do you want to increase your prayer life?
Yes.
The answer would be yes. Okay. How are you going to do that? How are we going to strive for holiness? Then a lot of times, kind of deer in the headlights look like, I don't know. I don't know what the game plan is. I don't know what I should be doing.
They just want it to happen.
They just want it to happen. Yeah. And so we got to be intentional Catholics, right? We got to be intentional about how we're going to be growing and striving for holiness. And so that's kind of what we decided to do with this book, was to put together ways to get practical advice for people who are very busy. The book's only 100 pages, right? So it took four of us to write 100 pages. So we wrote it for the busy family with just practical tips.
Right, and that's what it is. I'm going to give the number again. We're going to go to a break. We'll take some calls, 888-318-7884. It's rooted in a very deep theology, but it's not presented as a deep theology. It's presented as a how-to book. Here's how you do that. Here's how I could read, I can't actually, but I can pretend I can read Familiaris Consortio or something like that. But I could read parts of it. I could read the first page, the synopsis. I could read the cliff notes. All right, I'm getting more honest as I speak about it, but that doesn't tell me the nitty gritty of, well, yeah, but how do you actually do this as a dad, as a mom, as a family? How do you actually do this? So that's what I really, really enjoyed about the book. That's why I'm thrilled that dioceses are using it. Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. It's from Ascension Press. You can get it right now, but we'll come back with more calls and conversation with David and Adam, two of the four authors of Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
I had called in, I think, a month or so ago, and I had told you guys I was in my RCIA program, and I had wondered about what I could do more to get more involved with the church and such. Well, Saturday, I am finally having my confirmation, and I wanted to thank you guys for giving me all the information and having your program on here that has helped me so much. I cannot tell you enough how much it has helped me.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm a little distracted right now because I'm scrolling through the merchandise section of the Catholic Man Show web page. You guys have amazing merchandise. You know, I have one of your hats. You may not know this, but you gave it to me. As a matter of fact, I don't know if you know you gave it to me. I saw it on the table, yeah, and I thought they probably want me to have that. So I have one of the stocking caps. Oh, the best hats, the Catholic Man Show. So you've been doing the Catholic Man Show for how long now?
God, like 6 years.
6 years, yes, about 6.5 years.
Oh, all right. So 6.5 years you've been doing that. And now you've got this book out, Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. If you want to talk with Adam and David, 888-318-7884 is the number to call. And I'll be honest with you. I wonder if this is, if most people would think, well, this is a book to get for the wife, not for the husband, because it's not. But there's a certain way in which I think men think this religion stuff is for the women to handle. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, I hear that a lot, and I've never really understood that line of thought about religion being more of a woman's thing. I'm a cradle Catholic. I was raised in a good Catholic home, so that's always been kind of a foreign concept to me. And the more I've gotten to know the faith, the more that just is illogical. Because living out the faith often is arduous. It's like the calling of a father, especially, is noble, and you know, like practicing virtue in your day-to-day life, it's hard. There's nothing sissy about it. I mean, the question really is, are you man enough for it?
Yeah, yeah, and there's a lot of talk about the woundedness of young men now, and maybe they don't feel like they're man enough for it. A lot of people have, millions and millions of people have seen the failure of marriage in their own parents' life, grandparents' life, that kind of thing. They don't actually think you can do it, that you can be faithful, because that's a very manly thing, to be faithful, that you can practice the virtues, that you can pass these virtues on to your children so that they can be happy and holy people. There's just it's not a lack of faith in God, just a lack of faith in the ability to even do any of these things.
Yeah. Well, the truth is, Si, you can't do it. I mean, if you think that you're going to be able to get married to a woman, and the two of you being sinners are going to be able to live in peace and harmony together all by yourself, then it is going to fail. I mean, it's only through grace. Marriage is a sacrament for a reason, okay? Yeah. And if you're not availing yourself of those sacramental graces, it's going to be rough. And it's probably not going to work out, right? Mm-hmm. So, you can't do it. You're not enough. But praise God, He came and gave us all the grace that we need. He gave us a church where we have the sacraments, where we have the life of grace that we can depend on. And when you do that, when you're living that kind of life, then all things are possible.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me give you another objection, though. This one is an objection that comes from a good place in many people, which is, I do want this. I want this in my marriage. I want this for my children. My spouse is not fully on board. Because I at least my impression of you and your families is that you, as a team in each household, you are both on board. Now, maybe I have misread that, I don't know, but that seems a lot easier if you're both on board for this, all in, full, you want the Catholic life in your home. Mm-hmm. But there's not that many people you can marry who are all in with you.
Yeah, I mean, we got lucky because both of our wives are way holier than we are. I mean, it's unequivocally, like, that's just a proven fact.
Science has proven that.
It's science. I mean, that's objective. That's not subjective. That is definitely objective.
You can't open the pickle jars, and that's like, praise God for that.
Oh, so you have a role.
That's where we came in.
Okay.
Yeah.
I actually do provide something.
Right. But you know, as a man, we're called to priesthood, right? We're baptized Catholics. We're called to the priesthood. What does that look like in the domestic church, right? It's not a ministerial priesthood like we see at church, but priests are called to prayer and sacrifice, right? So even if your wife is not necessarily on the same page as you are in the faith, we're still called to prayer and sacrifice for them, right? So are you offering up prayers for her every morning? Are you sacrificing for her once a week? Exodus 90 is about to start January 9th. That's a great opportunity for you to kind of get your appetites in order and get your prayer life serious for your wife and for your children. And so, even if you guys are not on the exact same page, that doesn't mean that you shouldn't be praying for her, you shouldn't be fasting for her. and asking our Lord to introduce her to other good, holy women that can point her towards Christ.
Yeah. Yeah. So I would say, especially if you're the man and you feel called to this holy marriage, a holier marriage, most of the time, if you start living in a way where your wife sees that, hey, my husband, he's gone through this conversion and it has he's changed. He's not the same man anymore. Most of the time, the women will get on board. They see it in you know, if they see it in your life, they're going to want to participate. Sometimes I think it's harder, just in all reality, to get men on board.
We're a little bit more stubborn, probably.
Yeah, the tables are turned and the wife is the one who's really wanting to, you know, have this holier marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Men are a little bit more challenging. But I do think for the men, if this is you and you think, I want to pursue this with my wife, but she just doesn't quite get it. She doesn't see where I'm coming from. Well, be the husband that you dream about. Be that man that you say, that's the husband I want my wife, that I want to love my wife. Okay, be that guy and show her. And I think she'll come around. Mm-hmm. I mean, so it'll be tough. It'll be tough, but you can do it.
Yeah, but marriage is tough, and that's another thing. We don't want to exaggerate how tough marriage is, because it people have been getting married and being faithful to one another and living lives together all throughout human history. But it does seem to me that the media age has deepened people's doubt about whether. I don't even really know. You know, like you hear people say really weird things, like I don't even know if humans are supposed to be monogamous. Well, but humans all throughout history knew they were supposed to. How do you not know that? But
right.
Do you see what I'm saying? Like the challenges are enormous as far as the amount of doubt that's in people's mind.
Yeah, without a doubt. And that's why it's so important that you and your wife are on the same page, especially before you start, you know, growing your domestic church, so to speak, and your family. You start growing your family because you need to be. You know, Catechism 2223 talks about how we're the primary educators of our children. Right, so we're the first educators of our children, and so you guys have to be on the same page in order to do that. So in order to pass down your faith, there's a lot of good tips. We have it in the book. We'd like to share maybe some of them with you if you have any questions. Maybe we can get people to call in and tell us how they're sharing their faith with their children. We can take that and write a second book on it ideas.
You're willing to steal other people's ideas.
I would love to do that, actually. Yeah.
You guys really are authors. That's how authors do it. Congratulations. Yeah. You figured it out. The scam. Yeah. The number is 888-318-7884 if you want to do that. Yeah, call, share your story, or call and ask, because there's wonderful little chapters like living liturgically in the domestic church. Give us some tips on living liturgically at home.
Yeah, so this idea, living liturgically, I think that is really one of the biggest game changers. I don't know if it was around when I was a kid, but Adam and I, you know, we both grew up in very Catholic, loving homes, and it just wasn't an idea that we had day to day about, hey, the liturgy of the church for the day, you know, are we in ordinary time? Are we in Advent? The Christmas mm-hmm. season? Is it a feast day? That, okay, the liturgy of the day should reflect somehow in the home, okay? So, the next week will be the feast of King David. So King David from the Old Testament, he is actually on the liturgical calendar. My name is David, so obviously I have cake on a day. Any day there's a Saint David on the calendar, you better believe I'm taking, you know, like, hey, that's me. I'm all pumped about that, right? So
but
just
what a great idea,
the liturgy.
Yeah. Because that's something that the kids, then it's not like, oh, it's the feast day of this, you know, my patron, and you know, let's spend the next 4 hours on our knees, kids. But let's have a cake. Let's celebrate.
Yeah. No, really, living liturgically often plays itself out in the practical way of having more reasons to eat cake. So I think that's why it's so popular.
Yeah.
Yeah. Another thing that we mentioned in the book, and this is a practice that I really would love to see come back into homes, and I think is so beautiful. During Lent, Passion Tide is, you know, right at the very end of Lent. Often you'll go to church, and all of a sudden the crucifix is covered with a purple cloth, and maybe, you know, the statues of Mary and Joseph, and they stay that that way up until the Triduum, the 3 days, the holy days right before Easter.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a tradition where people would do that in their own homes as well. And so we've started doing that for the last several years. And I just think that's such a beautiful practice in my own prayer life as an adult. It's not always a liturgical living. It's not always about, oh, how to teach your kids the faith and pass it on to them. No, it should be primarily about how to live the faith well. And so in my own home, when I'm praying, all of a sudden all the holy images are covered, and it's like a fast, for a visual fast. And then when the Triduum comes and you uncover them right before the resurrection of Christ, and all of a sudden you kneel down to pray, and there you can see Jesus again. It's like, Jesus, I've missed you. And it's just a really beautiful way to prepare yourself for the resurrection of Christ, you know, when he's in the tomb and we wait. So that's just a really beautiful tradition I'd love to see return in practice.
Adam Minihan and David Niles are our guests. They are the hosts of the Catholic Man Show. They and their wives have a new book called Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. Your call's welcome, 888-318-7884.
Catholic Answers Live.
The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whywearepro-life.com.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at catholic.com.
Does the Church have too many rules? Join me, Dr. David Anders, as we answer your questions right here on Call to Communion, Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I really want to highly recommend this book as a gift, as a book for maybe you've got some young adults in the family who one day will be making domestic churches of their own. Maybe they're already in the midst of it. But Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place, is a very practical book for a very holy purpose, and one that really, if people will follow the advice in this book, I guess is the way I'd like to say it, is I just think they'll encounter a joy in the domestic life, a joy in married life and parenting that God wants them to have. I don't know any other way to say it, that God wants them to have. So please do pick up a copy. Get it for others. Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. It's from Ascension Press. As Adam was saying, it's very brief. It's not, you're not making a lifetime commitment. It's brief. The chapters are brief. Each one is very practical. People will find this helpful. They will not find it like, oh, thank you, a book to read. This is one where that folks will find very, very helpful. I don't know if you guys want to go to the calls. Did I?
Yeah.
That review was okay? Or
Oh, it was epic.
Oh, yeah, okay. Absolutely. All right. All right. I did. That's what. Yeah. Yeah. I don't. Okay.
It was wonderful.
Because you know, yeah, yeah. I do not want to tick off the guys from the Catholic Man Show. I just don't want that.
No. That was awesome.
All right.
We'll give away a book to the next caller. How about that?
He's already on the line. Bob in Texas.
Okay.
Listening on Guadalupe Radio.
Well, he's going to get a book, whether he wants it or not.
Bob, I hate that super. Well, you got a free copy, Bob. Bob.
Well, Bob, we will find you.
Thanks for your call, Bob. Go ahead with your question for the fellas from the Catholic Man Show.
Hey, man, I'm really excited to hear what you're talking about. I'm the director of religious education at our church in Abilene, Texas here. And this is our second year we're doing something called family catechesis. So for the first two Sundays each month, we actually have the parents come, and they're working with all of their children at a table, and they may be with other families working in households. So we do that the first couple of Sundays every month, and the last two to three Sundays per month, we have normal, you know, RE where they go off with their peers. This is the second year we're doing it. We feel like we kind of have a much better handle on how to make it work the best. Last year we didn't know what we're doing, but what we found to our great happiness and satisfaction is that these parents really wanted to do this, and we were very nervous about starting family catechesis because it would require the parents to actually come with their kids to RE, and we have had fantastic response from our families, and it's really built the community. So maybe it's more of a comment or maybe even a question for you. Is that something that you try to promote in the book or kind of with what you do just in terms of, you know, family catechesis within the church?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question, Bob. And first of all, thank you so much for taking that leap. A lot of times God is calling anybody and everybody to help with this church, whether you're qualified or not. So we definitely understand the I'm not sure what I'm doing phase, but it is I'm so grateful for your yes. We do, yeah. I think that a lot of times that parents want to teach their kids, they just don't know how, right? They just don't know what to do and how to incorporate their faith back into their home. One of the things we talk about in the book is like, how do we have family prayer? Like, what does family prayer look like? Because we don't want it to be awkward. We don't want it to be weird. You know, I don't know about you, Cy, but your children probably were like levitating above broken glass every night.
They're
but
so holy. It's very hard to describe them. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But, you know, it's very hard to get into the rhythm of prayer and like why we're doing it, why we're praying together as a family. One of the things we talk about in the book is that after dinner, we actually have a prayer board. Okay, and what we do is we ask everybody to have an intention within the family. We write it up on the prayer board, and then we ask what saint we want to intercede for us. And so that way it incorporates not only prayer within the family, but we get an opportunity to talk about the different saints that you know that the church has given us and why we're asking for their intercession. So it gives them the opportunity to focus on asking for prayer, who to ask for to intercede, and then also throughout the day, they get a chance to see that board and are reminded to go back to prayer. For, you know, so like I come in the morning and be like, oh yeah, my older son Luke, he's really nervous about the test he's going to take. He asked St. Thomas Aquinas to pray for him. I'm going to take a moment and pray for him. So it's just a daily reminder. Yeah, so I think it's really important. We talk like little tips about that in the book.
Yeah, we do talk about how the parents are the primary educators in the book. We don't specifically relate that to family catechesis. But, Bob, I'm really glad you're doing that because the truth is there is no catechesis that isn't family catechesis. If you are sending your kids to RCIA, or not RCIA, to religious education, CCD, whatever they call it in your diocese, and you think, oh, I sent them to class. Now they're going to learn the faith.
Right.
I'm checked that box. Then your kids are not going to learn. They're going to maybe learn something about the faith. But if you're checked out on passing on the faith to them, then they're probably not going to accept it someday when they get old enough to lay it aside. Very likely they will. So if they don't learn the faith from you, from the Father, then it's not going to really mean very much. And, you know, maybe God can break through and, you know, touch them and keep them in the church. But the statistics would suggest that that's not likely. So if you don't have family catechesis, whether or not you send your kids to RE or not, you as the dad, as the mom, you need to be the one who really are the primary educators. So you should be talking about what it is, telling your kids when they learn something at RE, you should be telling them something, how that's made a difference in your life, so that they come to know how the faith really does mean something to you. And if it means something to you, then it will mean something to them. So I'm really glad that you brought this up, because this is, I think, a trend that is starting to become more popular. Mm-hmm. We have a couple of parishes who have switched to a family catechesis model. And I think, just like you, at first, how did we pull this off, right? Because it's a new idea, but now they're settling in, and it has been very successful.
Yeah.
What do you think, Bob?
Man, I completely agree. We have found that it has worked so great in our parish. I mean, we already have a wonderful parish, and with fantastic parents that we're doing this stuff already. But the way I think it's really contributed to building community, just give an example. When we did VBS this last summer, we had as many volunteers as we had kids in the VBS program.
Wow.
I mean, we weren't even having to call people, because people knew each other, and they were like, okay, well, what's next? And he said, "Well, you got VBS coming up," and they're like, "How can we help?" But it really got it. Not only did it help for the parents to learn how to pass the faith on to the kids, but now we've got parents talking to parents, and we've got families talking to families, and Catholic kids,
Praise God,
hanging out with each other, and it's been fantastic. So, anyways, I would tell anybody out there listening, if you're at all wondering about family catechesis, I would just go for it. Knowing that the first year you're really not going to know what you're doing very much, but then you start to figure it out.
It's all right.
Yeah.
Well, two things, Bob. Thank you so much for that call and for, without your permission, writing the first chapter of their next book, because they're going to steal that idea for their next book. But they asked if we would send you a copy of Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. So if you hang on a quick sec, we'll get an address, and then we'll get you out a copy of Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place, the new book from Adam and Haley Minihan and David and Pamela Niles. It's from Ascension Press. It's what we're talking about. If you want to get in on this conversation, you are very welcome here, 888-318-7884. Those are already on the line. Don't worry, I am going to get to you, but I got to take a quick break, and then we will come back and take more calls for Adam and David right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
I'm Jeanette DeMello, Editor-in-Chief of the National Catholic Register and co-host of Register Radio with Matthew Bunsen. Join us every week as we talk with the Register's expert writers and editors about the news you need to know and offer authentic Catholic insights on the important stories that impact your life. Register Radio, every Saturday at 7 p.m. Eastern and Sunday at 11 a.m. Eastern, here on EWTN Global Catholic Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Despite what you may have heard in other media, there's only two kings of Tulsa. It's Adam and David. They are the Tulsa Kings.
Yes.
You did it. You made it. You are the Tulsa Kings. They do the Catholic Man Show, a wonderful show. They both live in Tulsa. And here's what I'm hearing about Tulsa is that, you know, I don't know if you guys know this, but I'll share this fact with you. Oklahoma's not really a Catholic state. I don't know if you had, had heard that, but, you know, it's like 2 or 3% Catholic or something like that. But this is what I keep hearing is with your bishop, and then you got a great deacon who's, I think, the chancellor of the diocese, and there's people like you there, that there's this beautiful Catholic community showing green shoots everywhere in Tulsa. Is what I've heard true about Tulsa, Oklahoma?
Absolutely. It is that a fact?
It is true. If you're not Catholic, you would hate it here. But if you are Catholic, you would just love it.
That's not true.
That's not true at all. Yeah.
No, I'm kidding. But honestly, the community here is great. We have like festivals, just like different families who are like, oh, like they throw a festival in the fall and, you know, another one in the spring. So like there's just so many. Great. It's just good. Yeah. There's just a lot of good things going on.
Yeah. Yeah. And building communities of families, like our last caller, Bob, was talking about. When you start having communities of families, not just communities of people who show up to Mass, but real families who know one another and interact with one another, help one another, encourage one another, then you got something really going on. Once you start having that, you got something really going on.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, they've done all kinds of studies on this. One of the main factors about keeping your children in the faith as they get older is, do they have friends at church?
So, if they
go to church and they don't know anybody there, or, you know, so if they don't have any friends in the church community, then there's going to be very little. How do you stay connected to it if you've got no friendship there? So, having a Catholic community is so important.
Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to head down south now to Fargo, North Dakota. Chris in Fargo, listening. I'm not good at geography. I don't know if you guys know that.
South?
Yeah.
South of somewhere.
exactly. Listening on Real Presence Radio. Chris, go ahead with your question for Adam and David.
Awesome, guys. South of the Canadian border, right up there.
Yeah, so, all right. South of something.
That's right. So I just want to share like a quick story. So I was studying to be a priest for a long time, and then the Lord called me out of that and told me to basically get married. It's been such a blessing for my life. So it's been amazing. The Lord just wants us to be happy, and it's amazing. I just wanted to say that.
You know? Amen, brother. That is true.
So, but here's my question. So I think everyone has like a secular part of them in their lives. Like for me, I love watching sports. How can you like baptize in your family that secular moment or that secular thing in your life? Like, for example, watching sports.
Yeah, Chris, I mean, I think that's a great question. I always think about like how I want to set up my kids for success, right? So when I go outside and I hear them talking about, when they're playing football, going for it on fourth down, if they're, you know, what coverage they're going to, you know, cover two, cover four, man-to-man coverage, running the ball on third and 16 is not a good idea. You know, they're talking about all this terminology and philosophy on football, right? And so because they want to be football players someday. They want to be able to put the helmets on and on Friday Night Lights, you know, go out and play football. Well, similarly, like we want to be able to teach our children how, like, if the terminology for football is like knowing what fourth and 13 is. If we're trying to teach our kids how to be saints, they need to know what the virtues are. They need to know the terminology and the philosophy of being saints. And so sports give a great opportunity to teach these virtues, right? Discipline, fortitude, being able to, rely on others. Like there's a lot of opportunities in sports to teach virtue. And so I think that if we use virtuous language, it becomes the goal, right? So if you tell them like, listen, this is what fortitude looks like. This is what discipline looks like. Then they understand and they can see it practically, and then they know how to go and achieve it. So when you're watching football or you're playing football with your sons outside, make sure to use the language that would set them up for success. So that way they know what virtue looks like.
Yeah, Chris, when you start to have order in the home, really all things become Catholic. Okay, mm-hmm. So there's no such thing as a not Catholic thing. St. Paul tells us to hold on to what's true, good, and beautiful, to think about these things, right? So football, is it good? Yeah, I think it is. As long as it's being consumed in an ordered way, right? There's certainly a disordered way to watch football, you know, if that's all you're doing and if that's the priority over going to Sunday, you know, Mass on Sunday, certainly. Right. But if you're doing it with order in the home, then it is good. It and it becomes Catholic, right? Because it's a beautiful thing to do. So whether it's sports, whether it's television, whether
music,
it's,
whatever.
Music or even our appetites, food, drink, whatever. As long as we have order, which is something we talk a lot about in the book, and how order is necessary for a harmonious domestic church, then all things become baptized into this proper place of the true, the good, and the beautiful.
Chris, what do you think?
Oh, no, I think that's a great answer, especially in a culture that seems to be away from virtue. Sports is like the only place that we can, not the only place, but one of the only places we can point to and be like, hey, this is, look at what these people have done to, you know, foster that skill of a virtue in their lives, even though they're not virtuous in every area, but they have to be virtuous in this area. I think that's definitely worthwhile.
Well, thank you, Chris. I'd like to send you a copy of, and I'm acting like I'm doing it, but David and Adam are going to send it to you, Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place, the new book from Ascension Press. So if you hang on the line, Edgar will get an address, and then we'll put that address in the mail to Adam and David, and then they will get an envelope, and they will stick a book in there, and they will mail it to you.
We'll have our buddy Jim send it to you.
Yeah, Jim will actually do it, but yeah.
Jimbo
Baggins. You guys are like, well, we're not actually going to do any work here. That's a misconception of how it works over here.
We did not sign up for that.
No, I want to give Chris. No. I want to give Chris some props because I think he did it the right way. I've told a lot of guys. My wife and I, we were involved with marriage prep here in the diocese, and it's like, look, if you're a single guy who's really looking to get a Catholic wife, you know, a Catholic girl to date, first thing you need to do is discern out of seminary. Okay,
yeah.
I feel like the girls, if they, oh, he discerned out of seminary, like, oh, like, he's so eligible.
That is a very Catholic thing. That is a very Catholic thing. And I have heard a rumor that in some Catholic, very Catholic places, men will, when they're not interested, will say, I'm discerning the priesthood. And I think that's evil. I think that's
evil. That's a cop-out.
Evil cop. Yeah. Not that all men who say I'm discerning the priesthood are doing that, but I've heard rumors that sometimes that is the
easy
way.
Just don't be a coward.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah, don't be a coward.
Because if you are, you're not fit for the priesthood. Okay?
Or married life.
Yeah, or married life.
888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. So you talk in here about hospitality. Now, we recently did an episode of Catholic Answers Focus, our podcast, with a wonderful gentleman who was we were asking about, well, how do you live Catholic social teaching? And he goes, well, are there any homeless people in your neighborhood? You could bring them into your house. And it's like, wow, that got really real, really fast. Like, but you can't always do that when there's kids in the house. So tell us about living hospitality as a Catholic family.
Yeah. So one of the things that you find when you really think about the domestic church is that the first thing that you might notice about it is that it's exclusive, okay? So it's not inclusive. I know inclusive is like, oh, that's the nice thing. Things that are exclusive must be mean. But actually, the things that are exclusive tend to be the best things in the world. Marriage being one of them. It's the most exclusive relationship that I, as a man, would love one woman and exclude all others for the rest of my life. And it's because of that exclusivity that makes marriage so beautiful. And so in the family, it's just this exclusive unit and it's set apart. That's literally the word sacred means to be set apart, okay? So as a family, we're set apart from the world. So you'd think, oh, hospitality is not something that must be really a part of this exclusive thing because, you know, you're like, oh, no, you're not a part of our club.
Right.
But the family is not enough for itself. So I have four daughters. I have a that presumably some of them might discern marriage, right? If some of them discern religious life, that would be great. But some of them are very likely to be called to marriage. So I have a vested interest in the community also raising boys in other families.
Oh, yeah.
Raising them in such a way that they will be worth worthy of marrying my daughters, right? And so if I isolate myself as in my little family, you know, and keep everybody at arm's length, you know, because keep out the world, then someday I'm going to realize my children get older, I have a real problem. So hospitality is the virtue that the family is actually oriented towards, even though it's this exclusive thing. When done well, with when it has the proper order, it actually is pointed towards, it's pointed outwards. It's an exclusive institution with an outward orientation, such that hospitality says, come, share the goods that we have. So hopefully your family life is ordered well, where you have good things, and those good things are given to you to share, just like all good things in life. And so hospitality is the virtue that takes families that might could be isolated from each other and turns those, you know, think about a neighborhood. Hospitality is what turns a neighborhood into a community, or a parish into a community. Instead of just being people who live near each other, now we're actually a part of each other's lives because of the virtue of hospitality. So it plays an absolutely crucial role. It's the end of the family in many ways.
That, I gotta say, that is one of the, that's a beautiful Catholic answer right there, and that's the name of our show, Catholic Answers Live. But the family is not sufficient in itself, even for the members of the family. That you can't, but the society needs the family. That is, society without the family is a useless thing. Like, it's a dead thing, really. Yeah. It doesn't have that the quality of community that makes human life worth living, really. That's a beautiful. You did a really good job, David. I'm
high five.
Blown away by that. By that
Catholic
answer.
King of Tulsa. All right.
But don't you get the sense too that. In a family like yours, and your children are still relatively young. They're getting older and older, but every day. But they're still relatively young. But I imagine that I don't imagine this. I know this is going to happen, and you guys are going to hear about it. Friends are going to come over when the kids are of high school age, and they're going to go, I don't have this at home. They may not say it to you, but they're going to they're going to see it. They're going to realize it, and they're going to want that. And that, so there's an evangelizing quality just in a family being a family.
Yes. You know what, Si? I'm so glad you said that, because I have found that the best moments for evangelization take place in celebration, in moments of celebration. I mentioned, like, we have these families in the community who like to throw festivals where it's like have 100 people over. If you invite your non-Catholic neighbor to come with you to one of these festivals, and you just see all of these Catholic families, just the joy and the, like, it's just a great time, and all the kids are just playing together. You can't not be attracted to it. And like, we have to, you know, often I think we think about evangelization as I need to go out there with my apologetics, and I'm gonna beat him down with answers.
Yeah, right.
Until he has no choice but to become Catholic.
Right. He will give up Sola Scriptura in my presence and renounce
it. I'm going to philosophically tap him out.
Yeah.
You know.
Right.
But that, he's like, it doesn't work very well. It can work with the right person, but a much better strategy is to just show people the joy in your life.
Praise God.
Especially if you can introduce them to, like, hey, we have a beautiful community. We want you to be a part of it. This is where you belong, is right here with us. I mean, that is effective.
And that's the kind of Catholic family that I know that so many people want to build, a Catholic family that's part of a community of families, that's part of the sharing of the good news with the whole world. And that's what you're working towards in this book, Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. I do want to thank Haley and Minihan and Pamela Niles for writing the book and letting Adam and David put their name on it with them. It's a beautiful it's a beautiful book, and you should get it. You really should get it. And I'm so glad you guys were here right before Christmas to talk about this, because go ahead.
Yes, if there are people out there who, like, heard what I just said and said, well, we don't have anybody who throws big festivals, who throws big parties, throw one. It doesn't have to be 100 people. You know what? Say, we're throwing a Mary Mother of God party this year. It's coming up in January.
January 1.
Invite 5 families over and say, we're doing this every year. These 5 families, you can count on a party from us to celebrate the Mother of God every January. Start it yourself.
Beautiful. Adam and David, thank you so much.
Thank you, Cy. It was a blast.
Much continued success on the Catholic Man Show. I want to keep saying the name of the book, though. Living Beyond Sunday, Making Your Home a Holy Place. You can get it from Ascension Press, which apparently is better than all the other presses everywhere, including Catholic Answers Press. But do get it. It's not a big book, but man, there's power in what's in here, because what's in here is the story of the Catholic family and lots of practical ways to have your own. We got to call it right there. We'll see you next time. God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.